This morning we're talking about handling the proverbial security firestorm. What do you do when it hits the fan? So let me start with an interactive question for you. Who here has been through a security firestorm? Bunch of hands are going up. Hopefully our panelists,
get them up here.
Because that's who we have here, are the industry experts with this. We're not here today to target, no pun intended, any one particular entity that has been through a security firestorm, because so many of us have been through it, but to learn from it. Use that knowledge so we are better prepared for when it does happen. Because as I've heard through a number of sessions, it's not necessarily if, but when. So what I'd like to do is introduce our esteemed panelists. We have Bill Downs, Roland Cloutier, Kostas Georgakopoulos, and Rocco Grillo. What do you do when it hits the fan and you're called into the CEO, CEFO, C-whatever-O's office, and you need to lead that team of incident responders? Let me start with this question for the panelists. How do you even know you've been breached? What may trigger an incident response plan? How do we walk through that? Who wants to start? Kostas?
Sure, thank you. I think there's a couple of ways, and some of which we've seen in the news lately, whether it's an external client calling your help desk and asking about some transaction that has occurred, or hopefully, in many cases, your own internal staff identifying some activity on the network or on an application that looks suspicious, and then you take in some proactive steps to identify what actually has occurred. And that could take some time, and that can be challenging. And again, I think from a CISO perspective, you want to be careful in terms of what you're escalating to your senior management team, but then again, have a full picture of what's actually occurred, when, and then make some very difficult decisions of informing senior management of what action you need to take. Imagine a scenario in which you are, you know, part of a critical infrastructure and you really have to notify several external bodies in regards to a potential incident, whether that's multiple regulatory bodies or the government, various law enforcement agencies. That then make themselves available to help you remediate that activity. And you need to factor in a lot of complex issues around privacy, data, who actually owns the data. There are some very specific contractual obligations that you need to be very aware of. And I think as one of the takeaways that I hope I can provide today to the audience is make sure you have a very good understanding of what the businesses are actually doing and signing in their contracts, right? There's nothing worse, and again, from my experience in going through an incident where you are identifying contractual obligations that specify, for example, the time period in which you have to notify when a breach has occurred, with some very specific actions, or in the worst case, where clients actually have requirements in their contracts, and there are stipulations there about coming in and scanning your internal network or your perimeter or being part of your investigation, and that being inside a contract that has been signed at your company. So you don't want to be in that position. You don't want to be talking about renegotiating contracts in the middle of a client notification. So
part of it is just being prepared. Yeah. How about you, Bill? How would you know if your company is under attack or perceived attack?
Yeah, I think there's the internal notification from your teams or external. Internally, what you want to make sure you do is that you normalize your network. You know what your network looks like on a day-to-day basis. So if there's any variance from that, that would be an indicator for you and your team that, hey, something's going on, something abnormal, there's some type of abnormal behavior. So hopefully that's how you'd find out. But I think we all know, unfortunately, that's not the only way you find out. Sometimes there's business processes that you want to make sure you set up. So for an example, we had an incident where we had a producer, a rogue producer, that had enough information to go out and reset a number of PIN numbers of our clients. Well, the process that we had in place is if a PIN number was changed, that we would have a snail mail or, you know, a US mail sent to our clients to say, hey, just want to let you know or confirm that you changed your PIN number. Once we got a couple of people calling us up saying, hey, wait a minute, I didn't change my PIN number, but I got this email from you, then we can kind of dig in from a forensics perspective to find out, hey, what's going on with these particular clients. Ended up finding out, you know, where it was being reset, and in this case, it obviously was made public, but we had several hundred PIN numbers that were changed. It wasn't because they were trying to steal information. It was really for a marketing purposes, right? He wanted to know what the client portfolio was and what their rate of return was, and then sent email to him trying to generate business for himself. So you have to make sure is technically you have the right controls in place, but from a business process perspective, you have the right controls in place. This case, it was a case where, you know, by changing the PIN, he really had legitimate credentials to get in, but he was doing abnormal behavior. So in that case, of course, our next frontier is we want to, you know, we've gone from having, kind of behavioral-based things in place, normalizing your network. We want to get to the next level, right, application. What's normal behavior for someone going into your application? Those are things we're working on now. Right now, well, as I explained, we've got more of a manual process in place. Eventually, we want to get the technical process. So we're seeing it before our clients see it. So for me, that's both internal and external. Rocco?
Thanks, Bill. You know, the three gentlemen that you see up here with me, they have the, you know, the ability to look at their own infrastructures and the companies. On our side of the house, you know, from a consultant standpoint, we're usually being notified after the client knows something. And, you know, Bill talked about having the right controls in place, having the process. The other thing that we encourage people as much as we appreciate being able to come in and partner with clients, having the right people on staff. You hate to say that, hey, it's as simple as people, process, technologies, but all too often, you know, companies are like trying to fix this with technology, or as Bill mentioned, the process. But having the right people on staff, that helps identify what's happened. When we're brought in, it's usually too late at that point. Either they've been notified by a customer, or a third party has identified that, hey, you've got an issue here that is affecting us. What can you tell us about it? And all of a sudden, it's deer in the headlights. How did that happen? In other instances, law enforcement. Hey, Rocco, we just got a call from a particular law enforcement agency without naming one, and they told us we have a problem, and they wouldn't give us anything else. And, you know, usually what the situation is there, they've got a much larger investigation that they're involved with. They, you know, doing a courtesy, public courtesy that, hey, you have an issue there you might want to take a look at. And at that point, we'll come in and begin our investigation. We've had a couple where the client really didn't have much at all, and this is going back 3-4 years ago, even longer, where they were notified by the media. Reporters started calling them and indicated, hey, you've got an issue here. The client didn't even know about it.
That's a bad day.
Oh, that's an incredibly bad day. So I think to that end, there's situations like that. And then I think another area where we come in a lot, you've seen the rash of breaches in the retail industry. We're one of the PCI forensics investigation firms. When you get that call from the credit card company or your processing bank or the processor itself, that there's fraudulent activity or suspicion of fraudulent activity coming on. At that point, we're brought in, and as much as we're experts in the space, we've handled some of the top breaches in the last decade. I think the challenge is there's no silver bullet or magic wand. We come in and just isolate it. You're always going to be going after that needle in the haystack. But I think one of the pieces that makes life difficult on both sides, in a lot of instances, clients, and we've got our AV, we've got our IDS, we've got our IPS. That's great for capturing the signatures and things of that nature. AV can only stop part of the malware, but still to this day, some of the investigations are going, they don't have the log monitor in there. And with, you know, well, it's costly. Well, great. Well, what's more costly? Wait until the crisis, and now we'll have a prolonged investigation without, you know, the potential success of identifying what's going on. Roland?
You know, I want to take just a little different spin on it for a second and take a step back, because we're talking about incidents and how to detect it and what is it, right? I think that's the biggest question that you will have to overcome in each one of your own independent organizations. So what is an incident? How do you define an incident? And then everything you know, rolls down from there. All your processes, how you want to look back at your protection and prevention infrastructure or your monitoring can all work out from there. But some of the things you have to think about is when you have to respond to a negative impact incident, when do you declare it literally an incident? Because that has legal implications, that's yeah. internal and external implications. You have to understand, it's not necessarily our decision to make that. You'll want to make that in coordination with your CIO, general counsel, people, so they understand that when you pick up the phone and you dial that internal 911 and say, hey, folks, we have an issue, that they know that they agree that it's an issue. And it's not at the time of an incident that you're actually having a discussion, well, is this an incident or is it not an incident, right? So, I mean, and think broadly. You want to, obviously, malicious activity, that's there. That's, you don't have to talk about. But is a single incident DLP, is that considered an incident? I don't know. If it has 100,000 client records, I'm going to assume it is. If it's just Jimmy sending something out to his, PayPal account or his, his Google account or what have you, maybe not. So you guys are going to, you have to think about that. Is it business processes gone wrong? So we weren't breached. We didn't, no one attacked us, but something certainly happened and we have to respond to it. And so think about the industries and the businesses that you're in. Is it actually something that isn't happening now, but happened months or years ago? You will run into that as you get as your program gets more mature or your business gets older. People will come to you and say, "Hey, we found this. Well, this happened a long time ago. How are you going to deal with previous incidents?" Something that's becoming more and more pervasive, at least in our operations, is things that don't even happen in our environment, but we have to classify them as an incident and respond to it as such in a responsible manner. So I'll give you a for instance. Anybody here with a pony botnet, right? That made my life miserable for a few months, a few months ago. And the reason is that it had absolutely nothing to do with our environment, but our brand was impacted, right? So what happened? A bunch of our clients, we have 60 million end users on our platform. About 4,000 of them had gotten malware on their own machines, and their accounts into our service network were compromised. And most of them were end users. So had nothing to do with our platform, had nothing to do with our business, other than people had malware on our clients had malware on their boxes. But we had to treat that as an incident because of the level of media activity and the potential fraud implications coming back inbound from those compromised credentials, right? These are all things that you have to plan for, because the wrong time for planning is when you're in the middle of it. The last thing I'd really talk about here is having to prove a negative impact event. So proving the negative, did it not happen? Often we say, well, we don't have the information, so it couldn't have been the incident. It's probably not the responsible thing to do. So as you build up your program and you start to think about what is and is not an incident, make sure that part of that identification process is looking at proving the negative, so to speak.
Great. Let's move forward, and you've mentioned it briefly about the plan and the whole planning process and the process for walking through an incident. So where do you start with that process? How do you start? Do you start by contacting certain parties? Do you do your own mini investigation triage, if you will? Bill, you seem to have a thought on that.
Sure. So let me talk a little bit about how our incident response has evolved over time. If I go back 12, 13 years ago, we had our computer incident response team. It was really, really IT-centric, right? And things that we handled were things like the I love you and issues like that. As data breach notification laws began to be passed, then we brought in the privacy group, and we called it data breach notification versus the CERT. But with that, we really expanded that team. That's when we brought in legal. Corporate relations, privacy, compliance, so on and so forth, to make sure that if we had an incident, that we leveraged the collective strength of the team. I mean, we were very good as far as our team is identifying and really kind of putting out the fire, but the pieces after that as far as notifying the clients or what are our accountabilities to notify regulators, because with all the different state laws, there's different requirements for each. And then as enterprise risk management really took a foothold in the company, then now we started to link our program to the crisis management program. So that's really how we evolve. So when we talk about planning, it's really making sure you've got the key players at the table, making sure that they understand what their role is and they sign up for that role. And then it's really the maintenance of the plan, right? We're all in a very dynamic business environment today. So people come and leave. So what you want to make sure, at least on a quarterly basis, you should make sure you still got the same contacts, same phone numbers. You know, run those drills, even if the drill is just to send out a message and have them respond to it. And then make sure that you do at least a tabletop drill once a year to actually walk through an incident. So I think the key is to make sure that you've got the game plan in place and you're not trying to build the plane as you fly, right? Those would be the keys.
Roland?
Yeah, you know, I would suggest, especially for those of you that are in larger organizations, that you consider changing the model a little bit. So if you have a SOC or tier 1-2 monitoring teams that do normalized security device monitoring, that you potentially get rid of that basic function. And so, for instance, a lot of organizations are going to a full-time critical incident response team. And they're really doing tier 3 and 4 monitoring. They're doing the deep dives on the root cause of incidents and tracking them back in a larger scale. And so that just simply, IR becomes a way of your business. It becomes part of your delivery methodology. I think that if you have that ability or you think of it as just another service that you're now delivering, you can go to the next step, which is thresholds. So when this happens, who do I bring in or what part of the process and plan do I kick off? I think best-in-class providers or security organizations are doing are things like having a dedicated IR workflow. So it doesn't matter if they're looking at a single incident IDS alert or they're looking at a converged correlation rule across 7 or 8 tools, that based on the type of information they're looking at, it always follows, it goes into a workflow system. So the information is getting documented, it's searchable later, and if it hits a certain threshold, then it breaks up into additional steps that you have pre-planned. So all the things I think the team here will be talking about is some of the pre-planning steps that you have to do, so when it does hit the fan, that the teams are simply going through their checklists and making the right notifications. I would also talk about the expanded team, because you know it is impossible to have always the right people in the room. In every incident, it's going to be different. Some days you're going to need someone from the messaging team. Some days you're going to need someone from IT's DNS group. You know, sometimes it's just lawyers in the room. That's always a fun day. But you're going to have to make that determination on the team. And sometimes you've got to call Rocco, right? So because we don't, you know, you're not going to have enough forensics. Like I have 4 on staff forensics people. There is no way that, you know, I'm always going to be handled the biggest incident, so I'm going to have to go out for a service provider. So make sure that on the major things, you know where your gaps are. I don't have a forensics person, or I don't have an X, Y, and Z type expert. This is the company I'm going to use when I have to call it. I have a contract in place, negotiated rates prior to the incident, if you can, and that helps out a lot. And last bit of advice is do it by region. So if you're a U.S.-based company and you're all different parts of the country, know that, you know, although Rocco can probably do it anywhere in the domestic United States, I'm probably not going to call him from Dubai, right? So
I know he's actually going there.
All right, so he's going to go to Dubai.
We have people in Dubai.
But wherever, just make sure you know your partners by region and that they're set up prior is the in your gap areas.
One of the things I'd like to go back to is talking about public disclosure when you're having that incident and that escalation. So, Kostas, maybe if you can talk to us about that, because you've had to live through.
Yeah, you know, I've had to live through a pretty interesting event in my past career. But let me just go back to, I think, what we're all saying up here, which is you have to have a plan, an incident response plan with your senior management team and have clearly delineated roles and responsibilities within the organization. You need to know who can speak on behalf of the company to clients. You want to ensure you understand the corporate message that you want to send out publicly to your employees as well as to your customers. And more importantly, you want to go through some tabletop exercises to address what's actually going to occur in the middle of that incident. You know, imagine a scenario in which you are actually notifying your clients, and I'll get some more specifics. And in the middle of that conversation, your security operations center is notifying you that they've detected some activity and that they've identified this corporate entity as performing some kind of a assessment, a scan, a penetration test on your environment. In the middle of that, and imagine now that you have multiple clients attempting to do the same to ensure that the message that they're hearing from you is actually correct and that their data is actually secure, right? So you want to be prepared for that. Are you going to allow that? Hopefully not. How are you going to handle that with your clients? And more importantly, in the event of law enforcement, right, that's another dynamic that you have to factor in. And I know you hear a lot in RSA here, and we've heard it, and we're going to continue to do that, about how important information sharing is. And it is important in the industry, and it is important to have a good partnership with your law enforcement contacts. But law enforcement in our industry has a very specific mission and task. And our mission and task may be similar in some respects, but it's definitely not the same. And we have some very tight restrictions in terms of our ability to cooperate and provide information. So you don't want to have discussions with your law enforcement partners or with your clients about sharing data, what kind of data was shared, or who has access to it. You know, in one of the cases I've been involved, you know, after we notified the regulators, one of them had a written request to bring in Nessus, of all things, to scan the network to determine what the state of our vulnerability looked like. So, you know, you need to sort of address some of the unknowns. And again, what if law enforcement decides to start scanning your perimeter network? You know, how are you going to react to that? You know, what is the message you want to have ready?
Kostas, I'd add to that, because you heard Roland just go through the whole technical end of things on, you've got your end case experts, you've got different areas of IT, you've got Kostas talking about calling regulators and law enforcement. But the key component, as much as Roland said, you know, you've got a room full of attorneys on a particular day. Yes, that is a bad day. But at the same time, for that incident response program, you need to make sure that that's your first call. All too often, you're running, getting your top forensics expert, or at the same time, even the CISOs, that, hey, call the CISO, or you know, maybe a senior most person on the business side. You need the attorneys. I had my wife wants to strangle me because this is a 24/7 job. I have my daughters are 8-year-old twins now. It's about 3 years ago. It's Christmas Eve. We're driving out to my brother's, big Italian Christmas Eve.
You're Italian?
Come on now, Rocco. Let's go. Come on. It's Irish. But I got a text from one of our guys on the West Coast, and this was a major breach that was going on. He said, you got to take this call, Rocco. It's clients, I hate to say under fire, clients in crisis mode. So I dial in, and we're driving out. I live in New York. We're driving out to Long Island, and my wife was like, can you keep the girls? She said, don't you start. It's Christmas Eve, blah, blah, blah. But we get onto the conference bridge, and one by one, everybody starts identifying themselves. CIO, head of security operations, CFO. I'm going down, I'm waiting, okay, all right. All right, there's about 20 people on the phone, but no attorneys. We've identified 200 of our customers that we have, we've lost their credit card data. And they're just like, uh-huh. And they're just spilling and spilling. It's just like, stop, now. I was like, where's your attorney in all of this? And it's like, well, he's away in Vail for the weekend, for the holidays and so forth, and we can't get a hold. And I mean, just that little bit right there, because it's not so much that you want the attorneys to lock everything down, whether it's your general counsel or outside counsel, you need to protect it. You need to protect us. As much as we're under a confidentiality agreement, that goes out the window once law enforcement comes in or you get subpoenaed. And even with the attorney-client privilege, you know, agreements in place, that doesn't make it ironclad, but it helps. So again, I don't want to, you know, go down that road too much, but this turned into a high profile breach. The Secret Service was involved, and the client, as much as, you know, Kostas was talking about calling law enforcement or regulators, Law enforcement is great, but at the same time, once law enforcement comes in, they want to find the bad guys. It's not so much that they want to hurt your reputation. They're going in, they're going to do whatever they need to. And, you know, before you turn over control, you want to make sure from a reputation standpoint, you know what's going on, you know what messages are going out, and, you know, the best way to control that is having your attorneys involved.
Bill, yeah, Rocco, Roland, but Bill, you were talking about your experiences working with law enforcement. Maybe if you can quickly share that, and then we'll get to Roland.
Sure. One thing, though, I do want to share. Kostas and I had a conversation earlier, and because we're on this, and I'll get to my point, but I thought it was very interesting. You know, our goal, all of our goal, is to protect the information that our customers entrust with us. So we want to make sure we notify them right away. But I want to share that story when you did want to notify, but there were reasons you couldn't, so I thought that was very interesting.
Yeah, I think in the middle of clear an investigation, you have to weigh some of the concerns that are visible from a notification requirement. And clearly, in the U.S., we have states and federal requirements from a privacy perspective. But again, just that law enforcement angle, particularly if you're in critical infrastructure, there may be cases, for example, where the government or law enforcement wants to take a closer look at what's happening. They may suspect state-sponsored activity. They may suspect criminal organizations, and they may be asking you or requesting that you do not notify or comply with some of those requirements. And again, they're trying to do their job. They're trying to do the responsible thing. But at the same time, you as a corporate entity have legal obligations that you need to avail yourself of. And again, you know, there are opportunities where you can reach out to the U.S. Attorney's Office, to your law enforcement partners, and request that they provide that same protection to your firm in the event they need to do a longer term investigation and something that needs to be notified a little later than what's actually identifiable in your contracts. So again, the mission that law enforcement has is a good one. We have great people there. I've had great experiences. Particularly the U.S. CERT folks are probably the best in the world from an investigation perspective. They're able to do some pretty amazing things. But we're not here to capture the bad guys. We're not here, to provide access to our internal network or to stymie any investigation. We're here to protect the assets of the firm, our clients, and our reputation. And we need to do that, and need to do that, in cooperation.
Good. Hey, where we've been successful, and we've had great success with law enforcement in any of the cases that we've had, but where we've seen it work very well is to make sure that we do as much work as possible so we can basically hand them the information on a silver platter. So, you know, their strength is enforcing the law and getting the bad guys. If you can give them the information to enable them to do that, that's been the real success for us, and it's we've built a real good partnership. And I think you really build up credibility when you give them that case, and it's pretty much ironclad, and they just go ahead and they do what they do. We found that to be a real win-win for both of our organizations.
All right, Roland.
Yeah, I'm going to touch on that. I'll come back to that in a minute, but I did want to spend just a second on some suggestions around when you're doing client notifications or external notifications. First of all, get the process down now. Say that if we're going to do notifications, here's the approval process. It goes through general counsel, or it goes through, if you have a PR group, whatever it is, who it is, or multiple contact people, so again, you're not dealing with it in the middle of a crisis. Things you'll want to remember: holding statements, extremely important, because if something, you're working on it, you're trying to identify what the issue is, and something leaks, or it was obviously, it was obvious to the external folks, you want to be able to have a bunch of pre-positioned holding statements that your business can use at any time. As often as possible, define client reporting requirements up ahead of time, so you can, based on the type of incident in your incident tree, that you can say we have X number of hours of notification required, and that's going to differ by contracts and by industry. I talked about the comms approval process. Here's an interesting one, because we're talking about clients, is make sure you know who's going to have that discussion, right? Is it the business going to do a mass email, or are you going to have your sales folks, actually the relationship managers, talk to the businesses that are impacted if it's client impacting? That's very important, because the way that message comes across can either come across as, oh my God, we're having a disaster, or listen, we had a little bit of a hiccup, you know, and X, Y, and Z. It changes the tone when you have that direct relationship. Arm your employees. I think that's really important. I'm not talking about us, our security teams, but if you have call centers, if you have places that people can call from the outside, you know, it's amazing what the media will do, right? Or clients will have a question, and if we haven't told our employees or given them specific statements to guide them, they're gonna be like, hey, I didn't even know, right? And that drives a bit of distrust with your organization. What I did want to say about law enforcement, because I have over 200 active cases open with law enforcement. We criminally prosecute 100% of all attempts against our infrastructure. So we're probably on the far aggressive side with it between fraud and cyber incidents. But it's just we hold a lot of sensitive information, move a lot of money on behalf of our clients. So we take a very aggressive approach. But I will tell you, in working with just about every federal agency, and a lot of state and locals, is that they will tell you what they can and cannot do, and what they can hold as confidential and what they cannot hold as confidential, and they'll help you through that process. So it's as, and you'll hear this through the entire conference, and I'm sure the Bureau and the services out there having the same type of sessions, but call them, they'll walk you through it. You can always have if I know a company that had this happen to them, you can have those conversations with law enforcement. They are there to help, and typically they can, a lot of the stuff we're telling you, they've been through it 100 times, and they can give you a list of things to prepare for.
I'd also like to add to that, because the big one, in terms of when do you disclose and things of that nature, as much as the three gentlemen out there are large companies, in a lot of instances, they can handle, large call in centers, or even distributing those proverbial letters of notification. How many of us receive those? Hopefully you haven't had to issue them. But, having someone on staff or on retainer in that instance with call centers, someone that's going to send out the letters, as Roland just mentioned, the last thing you need is your customers or clients that have just been compromised calling in, and who's ever answering the phone at the company not even knowing that you've been compromised. The other piece is credit monitoring. There's a lot of arrangements that are out there, third parties that have that in place. So, being more proactive, don't wait for it to happen, and now you're flooded with all these calls to compound the crisis that's going on. I think that's an important stakeholder to have involved as well.
One of the things I'd like you to talk about is the forensics and the tools that are part of this in terms of people, process, and technology. Rocco, you mentioned earlier about the PCI forensics, so you can be proactive in determining where potential breach avenues may lie. So maybe if you each can talk very briefly about the tools you use or the processes for forensics. Who wants to start? Roland?
Sure. I'll let some of the other guys talk about more specific in forensics. But let me tell you about the tools that I think you need on an ongoing basis to survive this type of firestorm. First is that you have to have some type of core log aggregation or ingestion platform that goes into some sort of big data store. It's going to be imperative over the next few years for you to be able to actually identify what happened in your environments, go historically back. And the only way you're going to be able to search the type of information you'll need is off some sort of Hadoop-like instance with some basic capabilities. From a log perspective, most of us know that we're going to grab all of our security logs, firewall logs, and so on and so forth. Logs you cannot live without: DHCP, DNS, and transaction logs, and at your application level. So focus on those. If you got to make your priority order, get DNS first, get your DHCP, and then move on and go deeper into the stack as much as possible. I think another technology that is extremely important is deep packet inspection. A lot of people don't have packet replay capabilities, and that becomes more and more important, especially in the early stages of an incident, where you're trying to really understand communication between networks, between devices, different transmission issues, and DPI-like technologies I think, you know, we couldn't live without it on a daily basis, and I suggest everyone takes a look at that.
Rocco, did you want to talk about
this? Yeah, I'd add further to that. We talked a little bit about it earlier from AV that it's not going to catch all malware. You've got IDS and IPS. As much as that's going to catch signatures, I go back to the monitoring and the logs. It's, you know, again, huge financial institutions usually have all the basics in place, called basic blocking and tackling. But the other piece is, well, we've got certified forensics experts on staff. Well, how often are you getting compromised? How active are these people? Because again, it's usually happening and you're in crisis. You don't have a crisis every day. And I don't know how many people are like Roland with 200 open cases. I think in that instance, Roland's guys are pretty busy and pretty savvy in what they're doing. But at the same time, with the different types of tools that are there, we were involved with a high profile breach a few years ago. Again, don't want to point to the West Coast, but it was a tech manufacturer, was in the papers and so forth. We came in through the client directly. The external law firm brought in their own guys. They had the lead on the investigation. They were tied to one of the leading forensic solutions out there. And that solution just wouldn't take the image in. And in our instance, and it's not to say just because it was Protiviti, but again, having a versatile tool belt. Most large forensics firms have a versatile tool belt. In that instance, the law firm had a reputable firm, but they only had that specific solution. So I think in that instance, even if you're bringing in a third party, make sure they have the diversity and a tool belt and the different solutions. Expect the unexpected.
How do you know who a good third party is, Bill?
Sure. I was just going to add the other important part of this is, you know, we talked about technology. Invest in your people, mm-hmm. right? Make sure your people are well trained and certified in this field, because you'll be challenged with the evidence that you bring forward in order to have a really solid case. You want to make sure your people are well-versed or you have a well-versed partner. In regards to the question, your third parties, you have to do your research. The biggest thing, I think, you want to make sure you have criteria for selection. So when you bring in a half a dozen firms to kind of weed out who you want, leverage your peers. You know, want to make sure you don't step in the same potholes they may have. So I think the relationships you have with your peers, we're all in this business together, regardless if it's my company or a competitor of my company. When it comes to information protection, we're all on the same team. So I would say, you know, make sure you do your homework in regards to bringing in a third party. But it's important that you do have one on retainer. I think Roland touched on it earlier. Make sure you have all that contract language done. Because as you know, going back and forth, sometimes it takes months to bring someone on with all the redlining between our lawyers and your lawyers. So do that stuff ahead of time.
I'd like to throw one other piece out there. And again, you know, looking at one of those points with the SOC, I had been a Protiviti about 10 years prior to that. Was with one of the first MSSPs built out of Carnegie Mellon. And the idea behind it is you've got a lot of global companies that have their own SOCs. Seeing more and more companies, the SIM solutions are just flying off the shelves. The manufacturers are thrilled about it. But I think to Bill's point, it's not about just, hey, let's go get a SIM solution. We're all set. Plug it in, and we're all set. You need to have the people. You need to have the process. And I think in a lot of instances, it's the blend of, in some instances, having the MSSP out there to do the monitoring for you 24/7. And again, when I say the 24/7, you're never just outsourcing it to a third party. It's more so to supplement the expertise you have on staff, the technology that you have implemented. And I think it's almost a step of defense in depth. Having the combination, having the comprehensive approach to it is what helps identify a lot of the gaps.
And let me just add, I think, you know, I just want to second what Rocco said. You know, we have a lot of tools in our enterprises, and we have, you know, all the tech toys that you could probably see at the expo hall. But you really do need to have visibility into what's happening into your network. You need to understand the way that the network is stitched together. Most companies have acquisitions. You know, they're living, breathing organizations. They buy and sell business units, they expand their areas globally or regionally, and that brings another set of challenges as you're adding more Active Directories into your environment or LDAP environments or online applications. you must understand how these things are put together, and you need visibility into that environment. And more importantly, I think you need to align yourself and give yourself an opportunity to detect those indicators of compromise. And these guys aren't doing anything really fancy. Even the APT stuff that we hear about, you know, the typical attack vector is compromising an account in the firm, gaining admin level access, and then expanding horizontally and vertically in the organization. And it can be very easily done. If you consider just your enterprise monitoring tools and the way that they're deployed globally, right? Whether you have an operations suite from Microsoft or from CA or from IBM, or even security tools that you're deploying globally, like your antivirus solutions, and they're running with service accounts, and they're generic, and they have admin level access, and one access, one compromise of one of those platforms immediately provides enterprise level access, right? And from that point on, it's more than a needle in a haystack. You have some really serious issues. So I think we just have to go back in the way that we're doing business, change up some of the things, some of the deployment techniques that we're deploying. You know, you really should not be deploying a single account and provisioning that globally to run anything on an enterprise level. If you're doing that, that's a major mistake. That's exactly what these folks are looking for, and you're just a sitting duck. You're waiting to happen. But on the logging side, if you don't have the logs, then you're not doing the monitoring. And if you're not doing the monitoring, you know, you have been compromised. You just don't know it. They're there, right? So again, just go back to some of the basics things. Look at your enterprise, understand how it's put together, figure out how you can change up environments. And it could be just as simple as taking one set of suite of tools, change up the account by business area, by region, and then setting up rules on your SIM or setting up rules in your environment that will trigger if some activity occurs with a credential that should not exist in that part of the network, right? That's probably one of the easiest things that you can do.
As we begin to wrap up, if you have questions you want to line up behind the microphones, that would be great. I have a question, though, for each of you. It's actually the last question on this. What advice do you have for a new CISO or a security manager who may be going through an incident for the first time? And also, where can we go to learn more about this topic? What resources do you recommend? Roland?
Take often deep breaths. So everybody's going to be in panic mode. People are going to be yelling. People get extremely emotional. You know, your job is to be the rock and to be the voice of reason. Overreaction is oftentimes worse than no reaction. So remember that, because people will be looking to you for leadership in your position, and that's what you're being paid to do. Second, when you're managing through crisis, right? Although we have technical jobs and these are technical issues, crisis management is as old as, you know, the human race, right? This is we're not learning something new just because our career field is budding. So go out to, government agencies have incident response classes, you know, 101, 102, basic things where you learn the principles of IRT or incident response teams and communications and team building and driving incidents. That is more important, I think, than you actually learning how to use a disk imaging device. Like, my guys won't even let me near a disk imaging device. You're not going to need, as a leader of incidents, necessarily to know the technologies right away. You'll learn that through the years, and you'll make mental notes. So learn incident response in a very generic fashion. Last thing I will say is there is no better lessons learned than lessons learned. So do the after action, right? Even after the incident's done, everyone's high-fiving, or you're crying and going to get a new job. do the after action to say, what did we do? You know, how did we respond? How didn't we respond? How do we have to change our plan? It doesn't have to be a six-day event. It can be a two-hour meeting, 3 weeks after, when people have finally gotten some sleep. But take the time to do process improvement, number one, and look at threat detection and management. Why didn't we capture it? Or why did that work? Why didn't we see it anywhere else in the world? Take a step back to better improve your incident management and detection capabilities.
Rocco, and if you can keep it to like 1 to 2 minutes,
sure. To Roland's point, lessons learned. We've talked about tabletop exercises. You've got firsthand experience if you've been through a breach. All too often, you want to sweep it under the rug, take the deep breath, and move on to the next thing. Take advantage of that. It's a great training opportunity at the same time to help you prepare for the next one. But so I would say some key takeaways that we've thrown through the entire presentation. Have an updated and robust incident response program. We talked about tabletops. So many people are talking about how many are actually doing it. We test our business continuity DR plan at least once a year. Why aren't we doing that with our incident response program? Retainers, make sure you have the expertise on staff. At the same time, have third parties, whether it's a forensics investigator, law firms, crisis management, whatever the case may be. Third parties, make sure that you're checking the third parties out. You can outsource the function, hate to say this again, but you know who owns the risks and who's in the papers when that data gets lost. One of the things we've been seeing a lot of, you know, everybody does the penetration testing, more and more clients are jumping on board with I hate the word, if there's PCI people in here, I'd have to do rocks, the mock rock, I hate that term, but a gap assessment. They're doing mock PFIs. They've been engaged us to do simulated forensics investigations. And as hard as it is to find that needle in the haystack during a breach that's been confirmed, come in and try to identify the potential breach that's out there. Other things companies are doing, red teaming. And we talked about people have been doing the pen testing, the social engineering. More and more companies are doing more than just talking about the red teaming. The final point that I'd just like to put out there, Roland talked about not getting excited and being calm, cool, and collective. I share this with a lot of our clients, especially when they think their job's on the line and we come in and what am I going to do? And my job's on the line, my executive management's screaming, law enforcement's here, the regulators are coming. You can do one of three things. You can run around with like a chicken with your head cut off or your hair on fire. You can take a step back, hide, and let somebody else run with it. Or three, seize the moment, because again, you see all these stories in the papers and things of that nature. You may be the next one in the paper, but have your plan there. And at the same time, seize that moment. That could be a career-defining opportunity for you, or you can run around with your hair on fire, and that can be a career-defining opportunity for you as well.
Okay. Yeah, not much more to add other than when you're in the middle of an incident, do the right thing because it's the right thing to do. Regardless of how that incident ends up, that's rationale that no one can ever argue. Based on the facts that you had at the time, you did the right thing because it's the right thing to do. And I think you and your customers would benefit from that.
Yeah, I would just again conclude by encouraging you to go back to your businesses. If you don't have an incident response plan, start one now, right? Start one now. Understand your business. Sit down with your legal team, understand your contracts. They're going to define a lot of the parameters that you're going to need to address during an incident response plan. You will absolutely need third-party support, whether it's on the forensic side, or on the pen testing side, on the threat assessment, on the risk assessment. You will have clients, you will have regulators banging on your door asking for all sorts of incredible things. Go through that exercise and plan for the worst. Because when it does occur, you'll be ready for it, and you will be, holding your head high and walking your organization through a pretty difficult time.
Very sage advice. I think we have some questions from the floor.
We got a couple questions. One was, you read that most breaches of data are notified to the company externally by law enforcement. How do you guys how have you seen that in your companies when you've had incidents?
No way. I mean, once or twice, we deal with incidents every single day, right? So when we think of incidents, we think about attempted breaches, not just breaches, but attempted breaches, data leakage incidents, whatever it may be. Law enforcement, they're great partners, and they do tell us when things go bump in the night or something comes from one of our IP address, blocks. But 9 out of 10 times, it's an internal discovery of some nature off of a threat monitoring platform.
I'll add to that, depends on the maturity of the company. And if you look at the three companies that are up there, not excluding Protiviti, that we're on the consultant side, but it varies. I mean, the three gentlemen that are up here, financial services oriented, large companies. But in a lot of instances, I mentioned that other one that not even law enforcement, media contacted a company that hey, you've got a problem there and your customers are screaming about it.
I would just like to second, if law enforcement is knocking on your door, you have a much more serious problem
yes.
that you need to address.
Okay, thanks. And another one, I noticed SOC up on a lot of the slides. And you guys make a large distinction in your companies between a SOC and a CERT. Is a SOC doing more security operations, adding accounts and stuff, and the CERT is actually...
My VPN's broke.
Yeah. Right, right. And then the CERT, the second part of that is the CERT. Is it all incidents in the company, or is it, are you trying to have that more just decided on the securities?
We're converged, so we have all incidents, so it doesn't matter if it's money movement or financial crimes or cyber, it all operates out of the CERT. All of our SOC functions, we've given back to IT into their network operations center. So they handle basic level one and two, you know, virus alerts and things like that. It's all up the hunting, the tracking that happens at the CERT level. So we've almost gone 100%, we have gone 100% over to just full-time CERT.
Okay.
Next question. Thank you.
Taking a page from business continuity and disaster recovery planning, but knowing that it's a big investment, have any of you ever done a full-blown, scripted, formal incident response drill involving not just IT and cybersecurity folks, but business operations, legal, and other areas, and scripting it so that each one has to be exercised in what they do based on the kind of scenario and drill?
I think we're somewhat at a disadvantage being part of the financial services circle. You know, there are organizations, the FSISAC, you know, comes immediately to mind when you bring that up, where we do hold sector level type exercises where we go not only through our own internal processes right. where we have the business represented there and the entire team from a DR perspective or incident response perspective, but also sector-wide to understand when something occurs at company X, how does it impact company Y, for
and
example.
Some in some industries, though, especially like critical infrastructure, like your power,
yeah.
you're kind of a disadvantage. They don't do that. And if you do it internally, you may think you may have a NERC-SIP a violation you have to report in some respects, some of the lawyers saying. So it does vary by industry, but I was kind of curious across the sectors.
Yeah, I think on the financial services side, it's a much more mature environment, much more heavily regulated, a lot more visibility, obviously, when someone steals your identity or your credit card or your account information. Bill, go ahead.
Yeah, for us, we actually have a stages of escalation. So for what we did, we combined what we call our CERT in our that's computer incident response team and data breach notification. So that's really one group now. But if it got to the point where it raised to the level where there'd be significant impact on the business, that's when we integrate with the crisis management team. And in fact, last year, one of the crisis management exercises was a security breach. So we actually walked through that and everybody played their role. So yes, we do.
I'd add to that, there's a lot of organizations that set up simulated exercises. We've been involved with FSISAC, and if you're in the financial community, not to say, hey, you have to be in the financial community to participate, but there's different organizations that go on with global exercises, and a lot of the financial institutions that partake in that, they either leave it limited to the security organization, the IT organization. You can make this as full-blown as you want. And even if you're doing this internally, I mean, you can go out there, look at the top five threat vectors that are out there. It's not necessarily customized. It's not necessarily specific one-size-fits-all. But take a look at the risks in your company, and you can almost script them yourself and carry it out. You've got to get the business involved. It's not, you know, just an IT issue. If you heard about all the different things we talked about, getting legal involved, who's going to call law enforcement, crisis management, other things, well, let's get HR involved, because guess what? It could be the internal, you know, we always hear about the internal attacker and things of that nature, and as much as we all want to lock that person down and kick them out the back door, if you suspect someone and it turns out that you suspect them without evidence, you've got a major problem on your hands, and then the lawsuits start coming.
So I'm sorry, we got to begin to wrap this up. If you have questions, you can catch us after this session. You see the key takeaways up here on the slide. We've heard about being prepared, knowing what to do when something fails, know who you're going to call, Ghostbusters, and then taking the time to learn from it. So please join me in thanking our SAGE experts, Kostas.
Thank you.
Bill, Rocco, and Roland, thank you. Enjoy the conference, everybody.